Today's episode of Kwibuka Podcast describes how killings intensified in Kamonyi starting on 14th May 1994. Many Tutsis fled to Musambira Health Center, hoping to find refuge there, but instead, on the same day, majority of men and boys were killed at the health center. The following morning, killers returned to kill women and children. On May 15th, 1994, RFI radio station hosted Interahamwe leader Robert Kajuga, who publicly denied all the Tutsi killings committed by the genocidal government. On 14th to 18th May 1994, massacres of Tutsis at Musambira and Byimana, when the international community was reluctant to intervene and save Tutsis. From May 10th to 18th 1994, leaders of the massacres in the former Chargwa and Tumba sectors ironically declared that girls and women would no longer be killed in that area. They pledged security and demanded those in hiding to get out of their hiding places and return to their abandoned homes. A man called Joseph Jaragoye took the loudspeaker and walked around the entire area of Chargwa, urging Tutsis, in particular women and girls, to get out of hiding because the government had restored peace. However, that was a technique to identify those in hiding places and gather them in one place. Joseph Jaragoye was sentenced and completed his sentence. He now lives in Muhanga district. Following his announcement, many Tutsis came out of their hiding places and returned to their abandoned homes in both Chargwa and Tumba sectors. In the family of Abaturagara of Bizimana Frederic, survivors went to their abandoned homes like everyone else. Sadly, the killers attacked and killed them every day for roughly 5 days. Also, they would come always to check if no Tutsi had escaped by counting. Minante Ernest was one of those checking every morning. On May 14, 1994, early in the morning, Mukachaka Severin was killed, and all the remaining girls were killed, as boys had already been killed. The girls killed that day were Wirajire Gotyos, also known as Jolie, Kanyindi Sinfroz, Musabgasoni, and elders, Nyiramirimo Suzanne, Nyirabimana Therese and her two children, Gracia Mukanwai, Kaisire and Nyirabukangaga Yolanda. Their bodies were moved out of their homes and thrown into a pit at a neighbor's house. The murderers killed them with clubs, spears and other traditional weapons that were later found in the pit when their bodies were exhumed to be laid in decent places. Other victims of those killings were hiding in various localities of Chargwa sector. Those killed included Tkwajiramuchiza Evariste, Gasana's wife, Victoria, Mukanghusi, Kagongo, Nyirakambi Gashamari, Nyirakabego, Madeline, Kavarisa, Benemhinga, Severina, Gagai, child of Burara Martin, three children of Nirora Vincent, Kanimba Inyas, Francine, Mitobotobo's wife, her two children, among others. Jean Bosco Nyambere had been hiding in the village of Tumba, and when we heard the death of others, he also surrendered to the killers. Perpetrators of those killings included Minante Honest and Uzajiriza Teresfor, neighbors to the victims. They were both sentenced by the Gachacha courts, but they have now been released after serving their sentences. Another perpetrator is Sehene Patrice, who escaped justice and now lives in Burundi. Many women and girls were killed in the area and dumped in public pits, depending on where they were killed. In addition, there were men discovered from their hiding places and killed. One of them was Mjimana Jean Pomsen, a young teacher who was killed in Kakarehe. There were many Burundian nationals living in Chargwa. They participated in the killings of Tutsis, but fled to Burundi afterwards. The tactics of lying to Tutsis that peace had been restored for them to get out of their hiding places was used to exterminate Tutsis who had survived. April 18th to 20th, 1994, that's when the last extreme killings took place in Musambira commune. On May 14, 1994, the killings intensified and some of the survivors of the massacres in Musambira commune fled to Musambira Health Center and the headquarters of Musambira commune. In order to bring the Tutsis in one place, authorities told them to go to the commune headquarters and at the health center. They were assured protection and shelter, for as their houses had been demolished. On May 14, 1994, attackers came and surrounded the health center and all men were killed on the same day. The corpses were so many and scattered all around, even in the goats and cows market. Therefore, Tutsi women were instructed to pick up the corpses, and most of them were their husbands. However, women refused to pick them, and killers started to beat them up, triggering them to drag the bodies on the ground and take them to the dump site for the butchery and the health center. On the morning of May 15, 1994, Killers raided an attack that was meant to kill all Tutsi children because on May 14, 1994, killers had exterminated only young boys and men, leaving children and women. During that attack, killers included even children who came with machetes, clubs, but were led by adult killers. On the same day, all the Tutsi children were killed by their fellow Hutu children, but women and babies were not killed. On May 16, 1994, another attack took women who were at the health center and handed them over to the killers at the roadblock established in Chakavidi. The killers at the roadblock did not kill those women, but instead took them to Kagarama and Nyarubaka. At those places, they met other attacks in which many of the women were stoned and endured all possible evils and buried alive. The killings continued in that area even in the days that followed. On May 18, 1994, Tutsis were taken refuge at St. Kizito Musambira Parish were killed. They included those who had come from different places and others who are dwellers of Musambira commune and other neighboring communes and those from Ruunda and Kigali who were on their way to Kabgayi. Killers massacred them by using guns and traditional weapons. After the genocide, their bodies were exhumed and laid to rest at Chibuza Memorial. The main perpetrators of Musambira massacres include Nyandwi Charles, mayor of Musambira, Karan Dominique, former mayor of Musambira, Yakaramyi Abdurrahman, Sekaziga, Rukunda Kuvuga Evariste, Jumugabe Alphonse, Karambizi, former councillor, Muhoozi Jafar, Harerimana Joseph Elias Nhuro, Foduar, a police officer, Randu Waridi, Vianne, Interahamwe, and other Hutu residents. During the genocide against the Tutsi, 105 Tutsis were killed in the premises of Jimana Secondary School. The school is located in the former Gitarama Prefecture, Muchinji Commune, Muhororo Sector, Chigarama Cell, currently in Ruhango District, Jimana Sector, Bukomero Cell, Muhororo Village. The school was run by Marist Brothers until the present day. Tutsis, especially those evacuated from Kabgayi, including Marist Brothers from Jimana Monastery, were taken by Uwamungu Jean Bosco, the head of monastery. The Marist Brothers had fled to Kabgayi on April 24, 1994, after their dismissal from the monastery by their colleagues. On April 29, 1994, the killers came in Bjimana School, took teachers Neziaremye Migawa Lazare, and went to kill him in Bjimana Center, where he stayed. Subsequently, on May 13, 1994, only Tutsi teachers at Bjimana School were killed, including Rubaiza Etienne, who was hiding inside the school, Gasana Bartazar, and Nyirakazungu Glorious, who lived outside the school. They were shot dead by soldiers who were in the school. Gasana was killed along with his son, Niragire Prudence. In addition, other people who participated in the killings included wives of soldiers from Gakwa military camp and injured ex-Faro soldiers who had fled there after the liberation of Bujesera. On May 24, 1994, soldiers took Jimana brothers from Kabgayi, where they had taken refuge. The brothers included Gatari Gaspar, who was in charge of studies at Bjimana School, Nyirinyindi Canisius and Bisengimana Fabien, both Marist brothers, and they were killed in Bjimana. Other Tutsis killed in Bjimana included brother Munyanshongore Martin, who was the head of Josephite Brothers with a headquarters in Kabgayi, Father Nyonshuti Celestin, former missionary at the Catholic parish of Bjimana, and a nun called Sister Benigne, one of the Abenebichira congregation. She was in charge of Kabgayi Nutrition Center. In general, brothers, priests, nuns, and other Tutsis are taken refuge in Kabgayi, especially those who are well known, including Karinda Viateur, a sports journalist from Radio Rwanda, and others, who are taken from Kabgayi and killed. Before bringing them back to be killed in Bjimana, their fellow brothers of Bjimana used to bring food for them in Kabgayi, with a hidden aim of identifying the refugees and monitoring their information until they claimed that they should be executed in Bjimana. They were shot dead and killed by injured ex-Faro soldiers who had taken refuge in the monastery. Those soldiers included Lieutenant Monique and Zai Senga, who was born in Bjimana. Some of the perpetrators involved in those killings included Namugabumwe Emmanuel, Nduamungu Emmanuel, and Chibihira. They were all convicted of genocide by the Gacaca courts. Others at the forefront of the planning of the massacres included Ndagijimana Joseph, head priest of Bjimana Catholic Parish, who was sentenced to life imprisonment by the ordinary courts and is currently serving his sentence at Nyanza Prison in Mhanga. Others were Brother Nkusi Francois from Chanika in Nyamagabe District, who lived in the monastery of Marist Brothers in Bjimana. He was sentenced by Gacaca courts of Muhororo Sector to 25 years in jail and he's serving his sentence in Nyanza Prison. Brother Wamungu Bosco, who lived in Gimana, he became a priest after the genocide and now lives in the United States. He was sentenced in absentia to 30 years in prison by the Gacaca courts of Muhoro sector. Rugamba Francois, a driver of Gimana school, he was sentenced to 30 years in prison by the ordinary courts and is currently serving his sentence in Nyanza prison. Niyamira Alexis, the former MDR president in Muchinji commune and a teacher at Groupe Scolaire Shogwe, he fled to DR Congo and is yet to be convicted. Radio France International Station, RFI, through its journalist Jean-Hélène, who was in Rwanda working in the criminal section, continued to broadcast information supporting the government, and Hélène conducted several exclusive interviews with the killers. On May 15, 1994, RFI hosted Interahamwe leader Robert Kajuga, and he denied all the killings committed by the government led by Kambanda, its forces, and the Interahamwe and Impuza Migambi. Kajuga declared that only Nkotanyi and their accomplices were being killed and not civilians. Thank you for listening to another episode of Kwibuka Podcast. As always, make sure you leave us a review, sharing what you like about the podcast, and share with others who would be interested in listening.